Today, we're talking about your engine's cooling system. Why is it important? How does it work? Can you use water as a coolant? Is it really necessary to do a coolant flush periodically? If your car overheats, what should you do? We'll also bust some common myths. So hop in and let's get going. Did you know that the modern cooling system hasn't changed all that much from the systems of 100 years ago? Of course, modern ones are more reliable and efficient, but the basic system still consists of liquid coolant that circulates through the engine and out of the radiator to be cooled by the airstream coming through the front grille of your car. Let's start by seeing what the cooling system does. Did you know that about 70% of the energy in gasoline gets converted to heat? Most people think the cooling system's job is just to remove the heat and prevent the engine from overheating. Now that is true, but it's more than that. It also works to maintain sufficient heat so that your engine can perform optimally. It's really a balancing act. That's because if a running engine gets cooled too much, then it becomes less efficient, its components will wear out faster, and the engine will emit more pollutants. The cooling system also allows the engine to heat up as quickly as possible and then maintains a constant operating temperature of the engine. There are two types of cooling systems found in motor vehicles, liquid-cooled and air-cooled. Air-cooled engines can usually be found in some older cars, like the original Volkswagen Beetle, the Chevrolet Corvair, and a few others. In air-cooled systems, instead of circulating fluid through the engine block is covered in aluminum fins that conduct heat away from the cylinder. Powerful fan forces air over these fins, which cools the engine by transferring the heat to the air. But nowadays, most modern cars and trucks with internal combustion engines use the liquid-cooled method. A fluid circulates through pipes and passageways inside the engine. As this liquid passes through the hot engine, it absorbs heat, thereby cooling the engine. After the fluid leaves the engine, it passes through a heat exchanger or radiator, which transfers the heat from the fluid to the air blowing through the exchanger. What about electric cars. Electric motors operate under a whole different set of rules than internal combustion engines. Heat isn't as critical for the electric motor. An EV's motor can reach 200 degrees Fahrenheit, yet still operate with no problems at all. But batteries are a whole different story. An EV's battery operating temperature for optimal use is between 60 to 80 degrees Fahrenheit. If it falls below 40 degrees or above 115 degrees Fahrenheit, then the EV's range decreases. And it can lead to battery damage and shorten battery pack life, hence the need for a cooling system to keep the batteries within their ideal temperature range. A few EVs use air cooling. For example, the Nissan Leaf uses an air cooling method to cool its batteries. But most EVs, like Tesla for example, use liquid cooling systems, usually within an ethylene glycol coolant. The BMW i3 uses refrigerant instead of coolant in their system. There are two types of liquid cooling systems in EVs. There is the indirect liquid cooling system, which parallels the liquid cooling you see in an internal combustion engine, except in an EV, the focus is to cool the battery, not the motor. Then there's the direct cooling system, where the battery cells are submerged in the coolant. But this method isn't used by most car makers yet because it's still in development. The maintenance intervals for EV cooling systems differ from EV maker to EV maker. For example, it's recommended the Chevrolet Bolt get a flush every 150,000 miles. Contrast that to the Tesla, who doesn't want owners serving their cooling systems at all. The owner's manual for the Tesla Model 3 states that the battery coolant doesn't need to be replaced for the life of the EV under most circumstances. If you open the coolant cap resulting in damage, they won't cover it under warranty. In fact, the Tesla cooling system is sealed and the EV will notify the owner if the cooling system needs servicing. So basically they're saying don't touch it and only take it to the dealer when it tells you to. In some EVs, the cabin cooling system helps speed up fast charging. The air conditioning system that keeps passengers cool does the same for the battery pack. In other words, the AC is for cabin comfort, and it also helps keep the battery cool and makes the fast charge even faster. The cooling system regulates the temperature of both the cabin and the battery pack. But let's return to the internal combustion engine. Want to know how overheating damages your car? Well, overheating can burn and melt holes through the top of the engine pistons. It can damage the seals between the cylinder head and engine. Overheating can seize your engine, meaning the electronics in your car will still work, but the engine itself won't even turn over. Instead, you'll hear a knocking or clunking sound. Overheating can also crack your engine block. It's a very, very expensive repair cost. So now you can see why it's good to care and maintain your cooling system regularly to prevent these horrible problems from happening in the first place. But how do you know if your cooling system is failing? What are some common signs? Well, a normal operating temperature for most cars is between 195 to 220 degrees Fahrenheit. If your temperature gauge is reading higher than normal, or if the needle is in the red zone, then it means your car is overheating. Especially if it happens more than once, it could mean your water pump might be failing, the head gasket might be worn out, or you could have a coolant leak, or your radiator may be clogged. It could be a bad thermostat too. You should get it addressed as soon as possible to prevent the problem from escalating into more serious damage. Another common sign is decrease in fuel economy. Of course, that could be caused by many different things. One of them could be a failing cooling system. If your heater isn't working the way it should, it could be a sign of a bad radiator. If your radiator is leaking or clogged up, you won't get the heat you expect. Or sometimes it can be due to a bad thermostat. Some people know how to check the coolant level in their radiator, but always remember to do it only when the engine is cold. That's because heat and pressure build up in the radiator, so it's extremely dangerous to remove the cap when everything is still hot. In addition to checking the coolant level, you'll want to also check its color, consistency, and smell. If your coolant is dark, dirty, and has a burnt sweet smell, it means the coolant is old and has become corrosive. Time to flush and replace the coolant. Coolant should be translucent and have a bright yellow or green color. Sometimes it can be pink or red. Another warning sign is steam coming from under your hood. And of course, if you see warning lights on your dashboard, you should take your car to the shop to get it checked out. Okay, now let's address some common questions and myths. For example, some people believe that the coolant doesn't need to be flushed, just topped up. But the truth is, the coolant, like motor oil or any other fluid in your car, will degrade over time. If it doesn't get serviced, old or broken down coolant can cause engine wear and corrosion. A flush doesn't just remove the old coolant. It also removes the built-up contaminants, including rust deposits and debris. It also thoroughly cleans out the cooling system with detergent and protective conditioner. And remember, it's important to fill your system with high-quality coolant to protect your car against corrosion, damage, and freezing in the winter. A common question is, can I use water as a coolant? Now, water can serve as a coolant with regards to heat conduction. It actually conducts heat better than antifreeze. But I don't advise using it as a coolant because it lacks corrosion inhibitors and water pump lubricants. If you don't believe me and you're using water as a coolant, well, that's your decision. But eventually, your hoses and pipes will rust and corrode, and you'll face serious repair costs later on. And if you live in an area where it freezes and you forget to put antifreeze in, it will crack your engine as it turns to ice. Another myth is that small drops of coolant under your car isn't a big issue, but actually it's not true. First of all, federal and state laws mandate that you can't dump antifreeze and other hazardous materials into surface waters. Antifreeze is very poisonous and can harm pets and children. But it's not only about preventing a safety and environmental hazard. Also, that a leaking radiator will eventually cause failure of your cooling system. Here's why. If your radiator is leaking, well, eventually it can split open. That means the rest of your coolant will dump out quickly. Or if the leak is in the hose will blow out. It's wiser and cheaper to address a leak sooner than later, generally as soon as you notice it. Otherwise, you'll end up spending more time and money later to fix the issue after it escalates into a bigger and more expensive problem like a blown head gasket. So what should you do if your car's overheating? First, kill the AC and crank up the heat. It might sound counterintuitive, especially if it's hot outside. You'll have to roll the windows down so you don't bang. But it does work to keep the engine cool because the heater transfers heat from the engine to your cabin. It's basically just a small radiator like the radiator in front of your car, only it's inside your car. Then after turning on the heat, find a safe place to pull over and shut off the car. If you're not too familiar with your car, then you should call a friend, tow truck, or roadside assistance if you have one. In the meantime, let the engine cool down at least 15 minutes or more. Keep your eye on the temperature gauge till the needle moves back to the normal range as the engine cools. If you're familiar with cars, then you can check the coolant level. But as mentioned earlier, you should check it only after it's cooled down. Otherwise, it's dangerous to do when the car is hot. If the coolant level is low, a quick top off could protect your engine for now until you're able to get your car to a nearby shop. But if you do drive it, watch the temperature gauge closely, and always refer to your car's owner manual for the location of the coolant tank and directions on how to add the coolant. Here's another common myth. Some people think engine coolant and antifreeze are the same. Actually, it's not. Antifreeze, usually ethylene glycol, does not freeze easily, and it also does not boil easily. Coolant is a mixture of water and antifreeze. Cars are supposed to run 50% water and 50% antifreeze. It's important to top your car up with the same engine coolant or antifreeze formulation that you used last time. That's because mixing different types of antifreeze can produce dangerous chemicals. Drain your old antifreeze coolant if you're not sure what type it is and can't match it. Don't risk it. Mixing coolants can lead to engine damage. So, as you can see, don't underestimate your engine's cooling system. It's a complex system that's necessary for the life of your engine and car. When your cooling system is working, you won't notice it. But if it fails, then for sure you'll notice it, and so will your pocketbook. If you like this episode, please share it and subscribe to my channel for more car technology and history videos. Thanks for your support.